It's great to have you with us. And we meet this morning primarily to point one another to Jesus, and as we do that, to give God all the glory. We do that together as a community in fellowship with one another. And as we do that, we're going to pray as we express our dependence on that God whom we give glory. We're going to hear from God's word to us as we continue our series in John with Graham. And we're going to sing as we encourage one another with wonderful truth. But as we begin this morning, I just want to be really honest. And I don't know where you're at this morning or how you're feeling or the sort of week that you might have had. Or I guess even why you've come to church this morning. Maybe you're here because someone else has dragged you along. Maybe you're here because mum and dad made you come, or your husband or your wife made you come, or your girlfriend or your boyfriend made you come. Maybe you even haven't even thought about why you've come to church this morning. It's just what you do on a Sunday. Maybe you're here because you feel like you ought to be here. Or maybe you're actually at church this morning and you really wish that you weren't here. Or you're just happy that you've made it. Well, this morning, as we're in John's gospel together, John writes, he tells us that he writes so that we might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing we might have life in his name. That's what Jesus came to do. And that's what he's doing today. Life and life to the full. And so wherever we're at this morning, wherever we're in the room, it is Jesus. It is Jesus who offers us mercy. It is Jesus who offers us grace. And it is Jesus who offers us life. And so would we look to him together this morning and praise him together this morning? Why don't we stand as we do that and just take a moment, if we stand, take a moment to still our hearts, to lift our gaze heavenward as I pray. Heavenly Father, you are an almighty, powerful, loving and sovereign God, full of goodness and grace. And Lord, we confess together this morning that there are so many ways that we have turned away from you and the life that you offer in your Son. And so we thank you so much this morning for Jesus. We thank you that in him we find life. And so would you lead us now by your Holy Spirit in a life of praise for your glory, and in Jesus' name, amen.
Bowing here, I find my rest. Jesus Christ, who has led and directed me. Psalm 103 says this. Praise the Lord, my soul, all my inmost being, praise his holy name. Praise the Lord, my soul, and forget not all his benefits. Who forgives all your sins and heals all your diseases. Who redeems your life from the pit and crowns you with love and compassion. Who satisfies your desires with good things so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. The Lord works righteousness and justice for the oppressed. He made known his ways to Moses, his deeds to the people of Israel. The Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love. He will not always accuse, nor will he harbor his anger forever. He does not treat us as our sins deserve, or repay us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his love for those who fear him. And as far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. Praise the Lord, you his angels, you mighty ones who do his bidding. Praise the Lord, all his heavenly hosts, you his servants who do his will. Praise the Lord, all his works, everywhere in his dominion. Praise the Lord, my soul.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul.
Lord Jesus, we thank you that you are gracious and compassionate, slow to anger, abounding in love. We thank you that you have rescued us from the pit and crowned us with your love and compassion. And Lord, we ask this morning that you would renew us again by your Spirit and your Word, that our whole lives might shout your praise each day. Amen.
Okay, good morning, everybody. Morning. Okay, for anyone who doesn't know, my name is Peter. I'm the youth worker here, and I want to speak particularly to the kids. So if there's any kids that would maybe want to come over, because we're going to play a game. We're going to play Would You Rather? Okay, Would You Rather Be? And I'm going to show you some pictures, and you're going to have to choose which one you would rather be. So kids, maybe while they're coming over, everyone else, okay? Easter is coming up. Okay, as you should know by now, we are having a community event on Easter Saturday. And the flyers are here to invite people along to that event. But it's not just for the community to come along to, it's also for all of you guys to come along to and mix with the community, mix with the people there, get to know them, build relationships. And if you are coming, what I would like you to do is to go to our website. Okay, this is our website. So if you go to our website, there's a thing that says Easter. You click on that, you get this page. Then you scroll down to the bottom of the page, and you will see there's a little bit about Easter egg extravaganza. Okay, Saturday, 8th of April. Tells you a little bit about it, and then there's a link there. Click on that. It takes you to a drop form, and then you put your name in, and you tell me if you're coming. Okay, so it's just number of adults coming, number of children coming, just so we have an idea of how many people are coming, okay? So I know how much ice cream we need to get, so I know how many eggs we need to boil to decorate for our egg rolling then on the Sunday. So please do come on Saturday, on that Easter Saturday, the 8th of April, and do please let me know and encourage the people that you're inviting to also let me know that they're coming, just so we know for numbers. Okay, right, back to our game, or let's start our game then, kids. Right, would you rather be Batman or his sidekick Robin? Who would you rather be? Right, how are you going to tell me? You're going to go hands up for Batman, hands on your head for Robin. Who would you rather be? Would you rather be Batman or Robin? You have to choose one. So I need to see all your hands either up or on your head. Choose. Quick. Batman or Robin? Batman or Robin? What are we going for? It's quite a mix. Quite a mix. Why have you gone for Batman?
Because he's like the main person.
Because he's like the main person. Okay, why'd you go for Robin?
I don't know.
You don't know? Do you just like the color red, maybe?
I'm Batman because I don't want to get bossed around.
Yeah, okay, you want to be Batman because you wouldn't want to get bossed around, okay? You think Robin gets bossed around. Okay, what about, would you rather be Batman or Alfred his butler? Okay, would you rather be Batman or would you rather be Alfred, his butler? Well, who would you rather be? Would you rather be Batman or the butler?
In one comic, Alfred beats Batman up.
I want to be Batman because I can have someone do everything for me.
Okay, you want to be Batman so that you've got a butler. Okay, yeah, fair enough. Right, okay, what about in a sports match? Okay, and it could be any sports match you're thinking of. Would you rather be the player of the match, okay? Would you rather be the player of the match or would you rather be the referee? Who would you rather be? Who would you rather be? Would you rather be the player of the match? Would you rather be the player of the match or would you rather be the referee? Who would you rather be? If you had to choose, who would you rather be? Okay, you'd rather be the player of the match? Why is that?
Because I forgot what a referee was.
Okay, so a referee is the guy that just has to run around the whole time. He has to run around and make sure that everybody's doing the right thing. Okay? So they're the guy that runs around and they just have to make sure that everybody's doing things right and they have to run back and forward, follow the ball, and make sure nobody's doing anything wrong, and tell them off if they are doing something wrong. Okay? And usually, at the end of the match, nobody really cares about the referee, okay? Nobody's really interested in who the referee was, unless they've made some bad decisions and they're like, oh, wasn't that referee terrible? So that's normally what happens. Whereas the player of the match, he gets an award and everybody goes, oh yeah, didn't they do really well? Okay? So what do you think, you would rather be the player of the match or the referee? Yeah, I think I'd rather be the player of the match rather than the referee. Okay? I think this is the last one. Would you rather be a queen, or would you rather be the queen's servant? Okay, would you rather be a queen or a queen's servant, like the hand servant? Would you rather be a queen, okay, or would you rather be like a king or a queen, or would you rather be the servant? Okay, quite a few people saying they'd rather be the servant. That's interesting. Why would you rather be the servant? Don't know? Who would like to tell me?
Because it's too hard to be royal.
Okay, too hard. Too hard to be royal. Interesting, really interesting. Well, last week at Kids Church, okay, there were two guys. Well, in fact, there were three people that asked Jesus a question. But the first two guys were James and John. James and John. Can anyone remember what was the question that they asked Jesus? James and John asked Jesus a question. Do you remember what that question was?
Can I sit on your right and can I sit on your left?
Exactly. Can I sit on your right and sit on your left? So one of them wanted to sit on Jesus' right and one on his left when he came in glory. So like when he was king, they wanted to be right there with him, sharing the glory. They wanted to be the greatest among the disciples. They wanted to be the greatest. They wanted to be the ones that would be like in charge next to Jesus. Okay? But Jesus said no. He told his disciples, he said, no, this is not the way to behave. Okay? You shouldn't be trying to be the greatest in this way. Instead, if you want to be the greatest, you have to be the servant of all. And it's where we get our memory verse from. Does anyone remember our memory verse? It's a test. Anyone remember our memory verse? Mark chapter 10, verse 45. Anyone? It's tricky. Putting you on the spot. I'll help you out.
For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and pay a ransom for many.
Oh yeah, well done, okay, well done. Yeah, let's get it on the screen for everyone, okay? Mark chapter 10, verse 45, let's all say it together. The Bible says in Mark chapter 10, verse 45, for even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and give his life as a ransom for many. And you see, Jesus is that ultimate example of a servant king, we sometimes call him. He was the ultimate servant. He was willing to serve, and yet even to give his life, okay? He could have come and just lorded it over everyone, to said, look, I'm your king, I'm your rightful king, you have to do everything that I say and serve me. But instead, no, he served us, and he wants us to follow his example. So he told his disciples off and said, no, don't try to be the greatest in this way. To be the greatest, you've got to be the lowest. You've got to be like a servant. And straight after that story, we get the story of blind Bartimaeus. And he had a question for Jesus. And he shouted, Son of David, have mercy on me. And people told him to be quiet, but Jesus said, no, come. And he asked, what do you want? And he wanted his sight. He wanted his sight, and Jesus healed him. And he got what he wanted. He got what he needed. Asking for mercy, okay? Not asking to be the greatest, but asking for mercy, okay? And we need to follow blind Bartimaeus' example. We need to follow Jesus' example. We need to ask for mercy and help to be servants, servants of all, okay? And you're going to be learning more. Kids Church should be learning more about from the book of Mark. You'll be learning the next part. So during the next song, there's going to be some notices. There's going to be a video, and there's going to be prayer. So we'll wait for all of those things. We'll wait for the next song before we head out. And creche, all the youngest ones will head out room 3 this way with either Luca or Simona and Kelsey. The preschoolers, those who are sort of around about 3-4 years old, we'll head out to room 2. They'll be with Bridget and myself. Kids Church upstairs, so all the primary school kids upstairs with Graham, Dodd and Alta. And in the embassy, you're also going out this week. You're going out to room one with Jonathan and Kirsty. Okay, so I'm going to pray for us, particularly for the kids. And for the kids' church leaders, who we are very thankful for serving you guys and for serving us. And if any of the younger kids are finding it difficult to sit in the service, then I'll probably be in the foyer with my little boy. So you can come and join me. But don't worry if they're making noise, really, don't worry. But if you're feeling like you might be better off in the foyer, you can come and join me in the foyer. But we'll wait until the next song before we go out. So let's pray. P-R-A-Y. Dear God, we thank you for Jesus. We thank you that he is the ultimate example to us, Lord, that he came to be a servant to all, even though he is King of Kings. And Lord, I pray that you would help us to want that for ourselves, to want to serve, not to want to try to be the greatest and to try to lord it over people. But I pray that we want servants, Lord, like Jesus, Lord. And we thank you for all the boys and girls here. And we thank you for the kids' church leaders. Thank you for how they serve us and serve the kids. And Lord, we thank you for everyone who's serving today at church, Lord. Particularly those in the background. Lord, thank you for their service, Lord. And we thank you for our mums, Lord, on Mother's Day. We thank you for how they have served us too, Lord. And we are very thankful for them. And we pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thanks so much, Pete. What Pete didn't say about that Easter extravaganza is that it's not free to put on an event like that. Obviously, it's absolutely free for you to come, and we would love for you to come. But if you would like to give money towards that, there's a card machine just in the foyer on your way out. And if you kind of click through that, there's a way to give specifically to that Easter event. So please do that. And there's also another event similar that I'd love to draw your attention to. And we've been praying for this for a while, for opportunities to share the gospel in local high schools. And that we've just been given this wonderful opportunity to do that at Burramuir High School. We got an email from them asking us to help out with some assemblies in the week running up to Easter. And it's just a brilliant opportunity for us to be able to share the gospel. So we're going to do that. And we're also hoping to give away some books and some Bibles when we do that. Again, that's not free. And if you'd love to give towards some resources for them, then you can do that. Just give to the Easter extravaganza thing. And we'll put that towards those books as well. And we're about to hear from the guys at Ferrywell, who are one of our mission partners, a short video from them. And then Ian is going to come and tell us a bit more about how we at Bruntsfield are involved at Ferrywell and pray for them. But just before he does, we've been handing out these Easter flyers. Hopefully you got one on the way in or you've had them before. And please take a handful and give them out to your neighbours and your friends. We'd love to invite them to what we've got going on over Easter. But we also really want to distribute them just in our local area and give them and invite our neighbours here as a church. And if you're willing and you've got time and you'd like to help us do that, please let Jill know. Jill, can you give us a wave? She's sitting at the back. Let Jill know if you are willing and able to help us hand out some flyers, because that would be really helpful. But let's hear from these guys at Ferrywell just now.
Project, and welcome to our little update. This is actually Thursday night, about 9:30. This is only our third take. There could be a few more. We've just had an evening with our seniors, and they've been particularly hyper. We've been playing a jelly bean game, if you don't know it, £2 from B&M. Recommend it. You can get good flavours, bad flavours. You could have watermelon or cabbage. Cabbage is crap. So we continue to have lots happening. We really appreciate your support. We have young people who are coming along to church regularly, asking good questions. One older boy recently was just really trying to get to grips with why things had happened in his life. And we've known him a long time. He's been particularly challenged and is now saying, God, why is my life the way it is? But engaging with who God is and who Jesus is. And that's great. So we really do appreciate your ongoing support, your prayer. And I'm going to hand over to Aaron to tell you a bit more.
I am one of the full-time members of staff here at Ferrywell. I have been involved in a group of work with a group of girls, taking them to the National Art Gallery and doing an art project every Friday afternoon. And it's been really exciting just to see some of these girls just explore art and be able to have different experiences with painting and playing and looking at how to design costumes and how to do photography. It has been really exciting just to have that time with the girls to build up the relationships and just have deeper conversations that you wouldn't have during the group times and times you see them through the streets and things. So that is one of the things that I've been up to. I'm going to pass over to Jane, who will tell us more.
So slick. Hi, I'm Jane. I'm part-time at Ferrywell, but I feel like I've been here forever. I was just going to update you a wee bit on the sort of one-to-one mentoring and counselling stuff that we do. We always have a massive waiting list at school because I think really the work that we do with one-to-one is one of our massive strengths at Ferrywell. And we still have lots of kids waiting on a waiting list, which is a really good thing to see. Also, I just think if you could be praying for us, because we're really conscious that a lot of the work we do is quite intensive now. There's a lot of kids with really complex lives and complex issues that we're working through, talking to each other about and trying to make wise decisions on. So just help us as we do that and try and support each other, but to support these kids and show them that they are loved by God. Thank you so much for all your prayers and all the support that you give us. It really does mean a lot. We're conscious when people are able.
I'm Ian, and I'm privileged to be Chair of Trustees at Ferrywell. So I want to begin, as the team did, with a big thank you. I know many people in the church pray regularly for the work at Ferrywell, and as you can gather from that, we need your prayers. Particularly the staff team face many difficult situations supporting young people going through real problems in life, and we really value your prayers for that, and also for the regular work in groups and presenting the gospel to young people. Thank you also to a good number of people in the church who give regularly. Monthly donations are the real foundation for the finances of probably any charity, but certainly of Ferrywell, and really appreciate those who contribute. Ferrywell grew out of work that was largely through people at Bruntsfield. Some will remember a lady called Sheila McBride, who worked for many years as a teacher in North Edinburgh, and it was from her work with SU groups that Ferrywell really started. Maggie Shearer also been involved for many years. And we still have quite a good number of volunteers from Bruntsfield involved. So, for example, Peter and Derek are involved in the work of Dine with teenagers. Bridget and myself are involved in separate primary SU groups. We have Margot and David Wright, who are involved in our work with weekends. Margot does baking, and David helps with cooking and in other ways. And Fiona Watson is also a fellow trustee. Apologies if I've missed anyone there. We would really welcome anyone else who is able to volunteer. I think the biggest limiting factor at the moment in the development of Ferrywell is the availability of volunteers. So if you can help working with children and young people, or helping to care for our building, or with communications, or with fundraising, do have a word with us, and I'm sure that we can fit you in, and we really value your support. We're hugely encouraged by what's happening at Ferrywell at the moment. We have more young people than ever. We believe we have about 170 different young people who are in regular contact with the work, and that's absolutely fantastic. And we do all we can to support as many of them as we can. We do have waiting lists, though, for some of the groups. Some children can only come every second week, so there's scope to do a lot more if we're able to. Something that's really exciting at the moment is we're starting the recruitment process for a new member of staff, and this person will be focused particularly on discipleship of the young people. Those who've expressed an interest, who have some spiritual interest in learning more about Christian faith. Some of them have already become Christians. So to encourage them, to build them up, to accompany them to church, and so on. So really excited. We're hopefully expanding the staff team beyond the three whom you saw this morning. And just a couple of final things to pray for coming up over the next few weeks. In the next fortnight, we'll be going into two of the local primary schools, Craig Royston and Fourth View, with Easter presentations for the primary six pupils. We were there at Christmas with Christmas presentations, and we're following up with Easter ones. So very similar to what Archie was talking about, a great opportunity to go into schools and to present the glorious message of Easter. And then during the Easter holidays, quite a few of the young people and also the staff team are going away to Scripture Union camp, and it would be good to pray for that as well. So thank you for all your prayers and support. And let's just now turn to the Lord in prayer. Let's pray together. Our Father, we thank you for the wonderful gospel that we have through the Lord Jesus Christ, that your Son came into the world, came as a baby, grew up to be a man, lived a perfect life, as we're thinking, not being served, but serving others, and went and died on the cross for our sins. And we thank you that as we come to the next few weeks of Easter, that we will be very much thinking of that, and that there will be opportunities to tell others about it. We pray for the opportunities there are in this church. We pray for the Easter extravaganza, and we pray that not only us, but many of our neighbours will come in and will enjoy the day and the egg painting and the bounty castles and everything else, but also will learn something about Easter and will come back on Easter Sunday to hear the glorious news of a Saviour who has risen back to life. We pray that through it, that there may be some who come to trust the Lord Jesus or who go on a journey towards believing in him. We pray for the assemblies in Birramure as well. We pray you'll be with Archie and the team as they go in and do that, and that they will be able to present clearly what Easter means. Pray that some of the young people will take the Bibles and books that are on offer there too. And we pray for the work of Ferrywell. We thank you for it. Thank you for many years of being able to serve in some of the most deprived areas of our city. And we pray for John and for Erin and for Jane, that you'll be with them in their work, that they may be spiritually and emotionally and physically strengthened, that they may be able to build up the young people. We pray particularly for the one-to-ones they're involved in with some of the most troubled young people. We pray that you give real wisdom and compassion for them in that. And we pray that the young people who come regularly, week by week, will understand the message of the gospel and put their trust in the Lord Jesus. We pray for the recruitment of the new staff member. We pray that you will be putting at the heart of the right person to apply for that. And we pray that you will be with the camps at Easter as well. As we pray for our own church, we remember particularly those who have special needs at the moment. We especially pray for those who are unwell. We lovingly commit Lynn to you. We pray for Dorothy. And we pray for Nan Wilson. And we pray for Fiona Ponton, for Irene and Lilius, and many others who don't get out on a Sunday and who are nevertheless much loved and very much part of our church. We pray that you will be close to them, that you will bring healing, that you will bring a knowledge of your continuing constant presence with them. We thank you for the privilege we have now of meeting to worship you and to learn from your words. And we pray that you will be with us as Graham comes to speak to us, that you will speak through him, and that we may be responsive to your word, that we will learn, but not just that we will learn, that we will put into practice what we learn and be obedient to you. We give you our thanks and commit ourselves to you in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to pass back to Gary, and we're going to sing again.
Let's stand together.
All to thee, my blessed Savior.
Great. Well, for those who don't know me, my name is Keita, and I work part-time for the church. I'm doing women's ministry, and I'm going to be bringing us the reading this morning. But just before I do that, just a quick notice for the ladies here, putting on my women's ministry cap. This week, we have our next installment of the Women's Monthly Bible Study. So that's every month on the third Wednesday of the month. We get together, we are going through a series looking at the God who sees me. So looking at individual episodes where the Lord sees someone in a particular crisis or challenge and then meets them in it. And it's really exciting. So this week, we're going to be looking at not the story of just one person, but two. We're going to look at how Jesus encounters Mary and Martha in Luke 10 and then John 11. So come along to that. It will be Wednesday night, 7 p.m., we'll be meeting actually in room 3 this time rather than in this main auditorium. So, but do come along to that. And if you have any questions, feel free to see me afterwards. So our reading today is in John chapter 5. We're continuing our series looking at verses 19 to 29. And that's on page 1068 in the church Bibles. Don't be put off by the little breaks that are there. We are starting kind of midway through one of the thought breaks that the writers of, or the NIV organizers of the text put there. So we're looking at verses 19 to 29. Jesus gave them this answer. Very truly, I tell you, the Son can do nothing by himself. He can do only what he sees his Father doing. Because whatever the Father does, the Son also does. For the Father loves the Son and shows him all he does. Yes, and he will show him even greater works than these, so that you will be amazed. For just as the Father raises the dead and gives them life, even so the Son gives life to whom he is pleased to give it. Moreover, the Father judges no one, but has entrusted all judgment to the Son, that all may honor the Son just as they honor the Father. Whoever does not honor the Son does not honor the Father who sent him. Very truly, I tell you, whoever hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life and will not be judged, but has crossed over from death to life. Very truly, I tell you, a time is coming and has now come when the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God, and those who hear will live. For as the Father has a life in himself, so he has granted the Son also to have life in himself. And he has given him authority to judge because he is the Son of Man. Do not be amazed at this, for a time is coming when all who are in their graves will hear his voice and come out. Those who have done what is good will rise to live, and those who have done what is evil will rise to be condemned. I'll go ahead and just pray now before inviting up Graham to speak. Father, just thank you so much for the blessing it is to be able to gather this morning, and we don't take for granted what a privilege it is to open your word, to read it openly, to enjoy it together, to hear from you, to learn from you, and to worship you. I thank you for every person who's here this morning. I thank you that I get to be here. Lord, I pray that you would open our hearts and minds, that we would hear from you this morning. May you anoint Graham by your Spirit, speak through him. And I pray, Lord, that you would be at work in each one of us, transforming us and renewing our minds through your word. I just pray this in your name. Amen.
Okay, well, good morning, everyone. It's lovely to see you. Lovely to see some new faces as well this morning. You're so welcome with us. My name's Graham. I'm the pastor of the church here. And let me just invite you to turn back to those verses in John chapter 5. If you need to scroll on your phone to find them, then please do that. If you need to use the contents page of the Bibles in front of you, then please do that as well to get God's words open in front of us. So there's a man who used to be the school chaplain down at Worcester College in Oxford called Tom Wright. And his pupils used to come up to him and they'd say, Mr. Wright, listen, I don't believe in God. And slightly provocatively, yet lovingly, he'd reply and he'd say, well, okay, why don't you describe to me this God that you don't believe in? Which I think is a cracking question, isn't it, in response to that? put the ball back in your court kind of question. Let me ask you, how would you answer that question this morning? Who is this God? Now, it was Julie Andrews, wasn't it, who sang that song about the beginning being a very good place to start. You know that song? And it's true, isn't it, as you open page one of the Bible, what kind of God are we instinctively expecting? Well, we're expecting a God who creates, and purely because of that, demands something in return. In other words, we're expecting a God who deals with his creatures, not relationally, but contractually. In other words, if we perform well for him and in his eyes, he will reward us and he will affirm us. But if we do bad, he is our creator who will punish us and dismiss us. It's tit for tat. It's I'll scratch your back if you scratch mine. As we find ourselves caught up in a spiritual and moral survival of the fittest competition. As we come to the opening page of the Bible, that is the God that I think as human beings we're instinctively expecting. And you see, that's often the version of God that pupils used to describe to Tom Wright when he used to ask them to describe the God that they didn't believe in. And when he heard that response, his response back to the pupil was, do you know what? I don't believe in that God either. You see, the God of the Bible is delightfully different to and doggedly defiant of all of our man-made shallow assumptions about who he is. This God who created the world, and if you think about it, he didn't have to create the world. It's not like he gets anything from it. He needs it. No. This God is totally self-sufficient. But this God speaks and creation happens. This God who created the world, who gave beauty to it, who gave diversity to it. If you think about it, God could have just made us all as human beings to survive on one food source. Is it not amazing that God has such a variety of foods in his world for us to eat? Not because God had to, but because it brought God delight to. This is the God of the Bible. Now, you might be asking yourself, why does that matter? Let me put it to you that who you understand God to be or not to be profoundly trickles down the streams of your life and it affects everything else, right? Maybe think of it like this. I don't know if this is helpful, but we'll go for it, okay? I had a fellow parent tell me recently about a school that used to have a really bad reputation, right? You know how it goes, poor exam results, pupils feeling unsupported, teachers coming at their job with low morale, that kind of thing, okay? It used to have a really bad reputation. But they said they've just appointed a new head teacher and everything has changed. They've turned it around. I mean, have you heard things like that before? Yeah? The person at the top, who they are like, it massively filters down to the rest of the organization, right? As they set the pace, as they implement the standards, as their character impacts everything else, as they create the culture, that influence massively impacts everyone else. So it really matters who we understand is in the hot seat. Who's right at the heart of Christianity? Really matters who is right there. Who God is and understanding him rightly affects everything else. Let me just say a little apologetic angle here. It's why the triune God of the Bible and Allah of Islam, we love our Muslim friends, very different cultures. And it all starts from who you understand God to be. I read a cracking book on that recently by a guy called Andy Bannister, who is a Christian guy, did his PhD in Islamic studies. If you want to check it out, come and speak to me afterwards. It's just in my room. Massively matters who you understand God to be. It affects how you understand yourself. It affects how you understand others. And most importantly, I think, it helps you understand the shape and the goal of the Christian life when you understand who this God is. And it's almost as if in John chapter 5, we're invited in to come and see the person who's in the chair in the school head office of the Christian faith. That's the invitation that's made to us this morning in this text. Now, last week in John chapter 5, we saw Jesus in heated discussion with the religious leaders. If you just scan your eyes over the first bit of the first 18 verses of chapter 5, you'll get a little bit of context, because what Jesus is saying here, it's not just a blog post, it's not just his thoughts. Actually, it's in conversation with creatures. The religious leaders are livid that he's had the audacity not just to heal a man on the Sabbath, remember there, Saturday, this holy day, but he's also had the audacity to tell this man to pick up his mat and walk on the day of no work. And because he's done that, verse 18, and here's the clincher, he's made himself equal with God. So this isn't a case of crossed wires. This is not a case of misinterpretation. Jesus is unapologetic in his claim as he steps into the world. And the guy's got some explaining to do. Okay? This all happens in the context of Jesus on the defense, as he explains himself, who he is. And the Sabbath, the healing, is almost the dig to the spike, if you get that analogy? He's teeing himself up to help the world understand who he is. That's the context. And I find how Jesus answers that question fascinating. He doesn't firstly appeal, and see this, to might. Because he could have done, couldn't he? He could have called down thousands of angels and flexed his divine muscles and said, see? Nor does he primarily appeal to right. Okay, we live in a world of rights. That's how we would have gone about defending ourselves. But you see how Jesus does this? He helps people see his true identity, and he unveils it in the context of explaining a relationship. Now that tells you something hugely significant about who the God of the Bible is, and it tells you something wonderfully profound about what it is to know him. Now Jesus has used that little title, Father, before in this gospel. He's used it in a count, I think, 3 or 4 times. But he used it as a title, never with an explanation. But here, for the first time in John's gospel, we're invited, almost as it were, to take a glimpse of the glorious relationship that exists between the Father and the Son. And all I want to do here in the time that we have left is just pick out 4 words that Jesus uses to help us get our heads around how that relationship works. And know that as we take these in together, we are rowing out into some unfathomably deep, mysterious, yet breathtaking waters. I tell you my mindset as I started this week. It was a bit like when I went with my daughter to Grace Mount Swimming Pool a few weeks back. You know what she loved to do? Favorite game. She's got 4 sinkies. You up with a sinky? Do you know what that is? Yeah. And the game was I would throw them in, they would sink to the bottom, and she would go down, and she would come back up, and she would hold it aloft like the World Cup trophy. Got my sinky. Okay, goggles on, deep breath, up she came. That's how I kind of came to this passage this week. But by the end of the week, I realized that we are paddling in the mid-Pacific. Okay, 11,022 meters down that bad boy is at its deepest. And you're not going to get a sinky when it falls in there. It's often said that the gospel is shallow enough for a babe to come and drink from without fear of drowning. But it's also true it's deep enough to swim in without ever touching the bottom. And this is the God of the Christian faith. You ready for a deep dive? You're getting a deep dive. Here's the first word. You just get it straight in the text, verse 19. It's the word seeing. See it, verse 19, Jesus says, truly, truly, which is his way of saying, mark my words. Underscore this, understand. Jesus says, I only do and act according to what I see the Father doing. So there is no disconnect between God the Father and God the Son. And I tell you what, this was a real game changer for me in my Christian life. Because I remember hearing when I was younger that the Old Testament kind of contained this big, bad, scary God, whereas the New Testament presented you with Jesus. And let's be honest, he's a much friendlier version of divinity. Okay, it left me thinking that God was somehow like that crazy uncle that you'd see at Christmas time who loves a rant and is prone to an odd non-PC comment. And Jesus comes along as the trendier uncle, almost apologetically covering for him. And if that's your understanding of how the Old Testament and New Testament comes together, if that's your understanding of how the Father and the Son work like it was mine, then can I just say we are in for a wonderful surprise. Because there is an exact continuity between the character of both. And it's more than Jesus is just like the apple hasn't fallen far from the fatherly tree. It's more like than he's just like, oh, he's so like his dad. The Father is exactly like Jesus. The New Testament makes a big thing of that. He is the exact imprint. He is the perfect stamp of God the Father, which means that if you're here today and you want to understand who God is, what is he like? The transcendent God. What is he like? He is like the God up close in the person of Jesus. So that means when we see the heart and work of God the Son, we're seeing the heart and the work of God the Father. And that's what these religious leaders need to see. Perhaps they're coming at this with a cold, shallow, moralistic and legalistic view of who the Lord is. And Jesus is upsetting everything. But there is a wonderful continuity. Jesus says, I've seen the Father. But lest we think Jesus is just a delivery boy for God, here's the second word, verse 20, and it's the word loving. So it's not just that the Father approves of the Son, it's not just that the Son is on friendly terms with the Father. The Father loves the Son. Do you see that in the text? We're just getting a little glimpse of this relationship here. The Father loves the Son. And so, the question, what was God doing before he created the world? Told you we're going deep here, right? Before anything was, what was this God doing? The answer is that the Father was delighting in the Son, in the joy of the Holy Spirit, and that delight was absolutely reciprocated. Love is not something that God does. Love is something that he is. And that's why we can say that God is love, because what was he doing before the world was created? He was a community of love. A wonderful union of three persons, of Father, of Son, and of Holy Spirit. Our God is not one, he is one in three. He is triune. And that's what the works that Jesus is doing are telling us. Every single healing and miracle is declaring to us that the Father loves the Son. He's not just a big fan, right? Not just a groupie. The Father loves the Son. And here's a thought for you. Maybe for some of us here in our Christian lives, our friends, our hearts get so distracted by so many silly things. Here's a thought that maybe has drifted from some of our minds. What is it to be a Christian? It's to be somebody who, simply by God's grace, that he has transformed our hearts, not because we're good, but simply because he is good. and that we have come to feel the same way about Jesus the Son as the Father does. Yeah? I remember the first time growing up in church and hearing an older man talking about how he loved Jesus. I said, what? But I can sit here as somebody who's almost 38 and say, I love Jesus. Come to feel the same way about God the Son, to honor him as God the Father does. Isn't that a thought for you this morning? That's what it is to be a Christian, isn't it? Love the Son. And here's the reason why that's even possible. Because of this third word, and it's the word giving. Yeah? Loving, seeing, loving, giving. Now, I remember sitting in St. James's Park down in London one hot summer's day with a good friend of mine. And he turns to me and he says, deadpan, he says, do you know what? If I didn't worship Jesus, I think I'd worship this. Do you know what the this was? It's the Son. Right? If I didn't worship Jesus, I think I'd worship the Son. Deadpan. And the thing is, I kind of got what he was meaning. You ever thought about what the Son is? Right? This thing that's fascinated human beings ever since time began, this enormous big ball of fire that sits in the sky, this giant centerpiece of our solar system that pulls everything into its orbit, the first source of every living thing. I kind of get why people down the years have worshipped the Sun, right? But here's a little thought for you, and it's Andrew Wilson. I'm indebted to this guy for helping me understand this over the last month. And this is a wonderful book. If you're looking for something just a little bit different for devotions or to read before bed, okay? He just takes the things of the world and nature and helps us see God's character through them, okay? He says this, other than human beings, it's hard to think of anything in creation that highlights as many of God's characteristics as the Son. Right? Stick with me. Think about it. Why can the Son give light and heat? Because it is light and heat. It doesn't need anything to sustain it. It gives but never depletes. Its action reflects its identity. Have you ever thought about the fact that so much of what God created was created to give us insights into who he is? Why can God give life? Because he is life. Do you see it? And by life there, Jesus is speaking about physical life. Okay, the kind that Lazarus is going to experience later in chapter 11. The kind of life that only our Creator can give us. Right, I was listening to Nicky Campbell on Five Live on Thursday morning. If you listen to Nicky Campbell, he was asking his listeners to phone in to discuss the recent studies that were showing that people are dying younger. Did you see that this week in the news? People dying younger. He said, what do you think? And it's a wonderful question to ask. And we're interested in the answers to that. And I know many of you are medically not just minded, but you work in the field. And it's a wonderful question to ask. And we care about it because we love people. Okay, but I'm sitting listening to Nicky Campbell in the car asking this question, but I'm thinking there's a deeper question, not just why do people die young, but why do people die at all? Okay, you see, you start seeing the world through a biblical lens. Welcome to a world where every death is unnatural. This is not the way God designed it to be. Because sin has entered the human condition and ruined God's good creation, we are now like flowers who die, and I don't want to spoil your Mother's Day, but who die the minute that we were cut off from the life source of the stem and are slowly wilting and dying. There is physical death in our world because there was first spiritual death. In other words, we rejected our Creator, and our sin has led to death in the world. There is physical death, there is spiritual death. And to nick a line from a song we often sing with the kids, when it comes to spiritual life and us giving ourselves it. Friends, a rock has a better chance of swimming and a potato has a better chance of dancing than we do of making ourselves spiritually alive. It's why when you speak to your non-Christian friends and family, and we love our non-Christian friends and family, it's primarily a spiritual reason why so often they just don't get you. It's why as we deny ourselves and as we take up our cross and follow Jesus, the world thinks that we are weird. As it contemplates a God-shaped worldview with views and decisions that come out of that, it's why they think they are so outdated and borderline offensive. It's primarily a spiritual reason why they look at Christians and think that they're actually the ones who have moved from life to death. And I know some of you are feeling that right now. The pressure that's coming from a world to say that you need to conform. You need to move from death to life. Whereas Jesus says, and we always need to allow him to form our world, to form our view. He says that for all those who hear and respond to his voice, it's the other way around. And it's why we should never underestimate the fact that you and I are Christians. And if that's you here today, however unspectacular you think your life is, however weak you think your faith is, be encouraged that you might not have a story that Netflix will phone you up and make a documentary about. You might have the most boring story in the world, but make no mistake, if your faith is in Christ, then you have passed, because of his grace, from death to life. And that life is a gift from Jesus. It's like a balloon that you blow up for your birthday party, right? You ever done that recently? Remember little girl's birthday in the beginning of March? Blowing up these balloons, right? Just picture it, right? Just blowing up a balloon. And that's what the Bible's talking about it when it says God has given us spiritual life. Balloon's dead, right? Balloon is dead. And along comes Jesus and blows the breath of life into us and we become spiritually alive, just like the balloon. Because he is the Lord of life and light, that's who he is. Now, why can he do this? Because Jesus didn't just enter our world of death and darkness. He became the penalty that we deserve for our rejection of God as he hung on the cross. Why can he raise the dead? Why can he give life? Because he bore our penalty on the cross for our sin in our place, and he rose. And the resurrection life that he enjoys, he imparts it to his people. So if you're here today and the fact that you're a Christian doesn't get your heart singing, doesn't make you think it's a big deal, this text would tell you to think again. That you have passed from death to life. Not because of the strength of your faith, not because of your affections for him, not because of our hearts are so often weary. We have passed from death to life because God the Son breathed spiritual life into us and we moved over. All the praise goes to him. And do you see how in the text it tells us that God the Son didn't just feel indifferent about that? Friends, it pleases him to give life. It's his good pleasure to give eternal life to his people. He's the giving God. And lastly, just really quickly, fourthly, he's the judging God. Because the Father has given, do you see verse 27, all judgment, all authority to the Son. Jesus calls himself here the Son of Man. What he's doing there is he's just taking a divine title that the Jews would have understood from Daniel chapter 7, where Daniel's talking about the Son of Man who's going to come. Daniel's speaking there about the divine warrior king who God would appoint and who would come to bring in victory and rule for his people. And caught up in this idea of the Son of Man is this idea of God in him defeating decisively evil. And Jesus is saying to this generation, he's saying to our generation, God the Father has given me that role. He's given me that role. This God is blindingly holy. This God cannot tolerate evil. Friends, do not mistake his patience with his approval. No, this God will one day, in the person of Jesus, come back. And he will make all things new. The Father and the Son are committed to each other's honor. And so the question is, friends, will we honor the Son? Will we honor Jesus? And on that day, the Son will rouse every human being who's ever existed, and all will be judged on how they've responded to him. Seeing, loving, giving, judging. So friends, tell me about this God you don't believe in. Here he is this morning. Is this him? Is this the God you've got in your mind? What do we do with this? Well, really the response we need to make comes in the word that appears four times from verse 25. And it's the word hear, right? Will you hear him? Will you find life in his words and his work? You know, just as we close and leave you with this thought when we think about application. I had coffee with a good friend of mine the other week. And I look at his phone. And I notice that his phone is in black and white. What he's done is I didn't even know you could do this on phones. He's turned the tint of his phone right down. Some of you might do that, I don't know. I said, why are you doing that? And he just said that because when it's full color, it just demands my attention all the time. All the time. Texts are going. Notifications are going. And he just says, I keep looking at it all the time. Right? You know, it's true with your phones, don't you? It's always demanding your attention. It's remember when I used to work in law and we used to have BlackBerries? Right, remember those days, good days? Just remember the red flash on the eye, right? The people I worked with used to call it the red eye of Mordor, right? It was just calling you in, come and answer me. It's why they call them, isn't it? They had the joke about BlackBerries being crackberries, wasn't it? Because we get addicted to our phones. They're just shouting for our attention all the time. I think that's why there is something in the fact that our generation is information heavy but wisdom light. Because our phones, and here's the point, are forming us. They're forming us all the time. And it's scary, isn't it, when you get that notification on your phone that says how long you've been on it last week. And the question is, we are in a world that is fighting to form us. And we've got to take that seriously, haven't we? The things that are going in, the things that are shaping us. The big biblical principle is that we become what we behold. As we think about where we spend our hours, the things that our eyes take in, the things that our minds comprehend, we are becoming what we behold. And the invitation of this passage is to make that thing the one who gives life. Are we gazing at Christ? Are we delighting? Are we feeding our souls in him? Are we allowing the words of the Good Shepherd to draw alongside us and quench our souls? Are we gazing at him and the life that he offers and becoming more like him? So this is the promise he makes, and we end with this. Very truly I tell you, whoever hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life and will not be judged, but is crossed over from death to life. Let's pray. And so, wonderful and gracious Father, thank you for your word. Thank you that you are a God who has revealed yourself. Lord, we would be have no idea. We would be in the dark if you hadn't done that. Father, thank you that you've revealed yourself in creation. Father, thank you that you've revealed yourself in your word. And thank you for that special revelation that comes as we look at Jesus in action. And so, Father, I pray for us here this morning, Lord, that our understanding, our view of who you are, it would be shaped, and you would shape it and hone it so that truth is the thing that guides our understanding about who you are. Father, I pray for those of us here this morning who have drifted maybe in their affections, whose hearts are weary, that, Lord, that you, the God who delights to give life, Father, that by your Spirit you would draw alongside us this morning. And, Father, build us up and strengthen us as your people. Father, for those maybe that are here this morning who don't know you, Father, may today be the day where they come to trust in Jesus the Son. Father, we thank you for our time this morning. And we pray all of these things in Jesus' worthy and precious name. Amen. Amen.
The blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. And so precious is the makes me white as snow.
Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for Jesus. We thank you for all that he has done for us. We thank you that through him we can be moved from the realm of death to life. And Lord, I pray that by your Holy Spirit, you would help us all to live lives of praise to you and through him. For we pray in his precious name. Amen. Do take a seat. And thank you all so much for coming, for being here this morning. It's been wonderful to worship with you. Just a couple of things before you go. We are meeting again this evening for our evening equip service and going through the book of Philippians. There's more info on these little postcards which you can grab on your way out. Do also grab a copy of this book, Is Easter Unbelievable by Rebecca McLaughlin. It's a wonderful book. Maybe grab two copies, read it yourself, give one away. This is a really, really great book. And please don't rush off and hang around. There'll be tea and coffee as ever. And let's finish with these words from Ephesians chapter 3. Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all that we ask or imagine, according to the power at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all the generations, forever and ever. Amen.